And it is our duty as loyal Americans to shut up.
Mediamagnaat Rupert Murdoch, eigenaar van 9 satellietzenders, 100 kabelnetten, 175 kranten en 40 tv-stations wereldwijd, kocht in 1996 de Amerikaanse nieuwszender Fox News. Ondertussen is Fox News de meest bekeken nieuwszender van de Verenigde Staten. En wie dacht dat propaganda via de nieuwsmedia sinds de val van de muur tot het verleden behoorde, kijkt met de Amerikaanse verkiezingen van volgende week in het achterhoofd de komende 50 minuten mee naar Rupert Murdoch's Fox News.
I'd just like to say how delighted I am that we've now reached this moment when we can firmly announce the starting of a Fox News channel and a much greater effort on the build-up of Fox News in every area.
We'd like to be premier journalists. We'd like to restore objectivity where we find it lacking, and certainly there could be that interpretation because of my background, but I left politics a number of years ago and have run a news organization for the last 2 years. So we just expect to do fine, balanced journalism.
I've heard directly from folks, both as correspondents and as bookers, who've expressed very great reservations, almost as if they're being monitored by a Stalinist system, afraid to be seen talking to the wrong person or having the wrong kind of email exchange.
It was made very clear to us that our activities were being monitored, and if someone wasn't watching it live, they were at least recording it, and they would review it after the fact to see what we did.
We weren't necessarily, as it was told to us, a news gathering organization so much as we were a proponent of a point of view.
I'd been warned by people. There were a number of people who pulled me inside and said, look, you know, I don't know. I mean, I know that you want to work and I know that you need a job, but you might want to think twice about taking this job because really it is a very conservative news network.
I suspect your research has discovered the memoranda that were written by John Moody and by Roger in terms of setting the tone for the day. The message of the day is a very political device.
Let's spend a good deal of time on the battle over judicial nominations, which the president will address this morning. Nominees who both sides admit are qualified are being held up because of their possible, not demonstrated, views on one issue, abortion. This should be a trademark issue for FNC today and in the days to come.
There was nothing covert about the way the managing editors in New York or Washington operated. They made it perfectly clear what they expected from us.
The so-called 9/11 Commission has already been meeting. This is not what did he know and when did he know it stuff. Do not turn this into Watergate.
Every morning, there was a detailed list of subjects to talk about, not talk about.
Kerry's speech on the economy at Georgetown is likely to move on to the topic of Iraq. We should take the beginning of the Kerry speech and see if other news at the time is more compelling. It is not required to take it start to finish.
They were just actually issuing edicts to the reporters to control what they could say and how they could say it.
Let's refer to the U.S. Marines we see in the foreground as sharpshooters, not snipers, which carries a negative connotation.
When headquarters sent a memo every morning and said, we want to touch on the following issues, we want to cover the following stories, we want to do them in this particular way, our job and our objective then was to execute the plan.
The pictures from Abu Ghraib prison are disturbing. Today we have a picture, aired on Al Arabiya, of an American hostage being held with a scarf over his eyes, clearly against his will. Who's outraged on his behalf?
The real revolutionary breakthrough of Fox has been it's eliminated journalism. I mean, that's the thing to understand. What Fox News Channel has done is it's stripped out any notion of journalism as we've traditionally understood it from its product. There is no journalism at the Fox News Channel.
Why?
Listen, cut his mic.
Chad, I'm going to test if you're an honest individual.
I'm sorry to cut you off. I know we're in some controversial stuff here, but my religion didn't teach me that. But thank you very much for being here.
It's a right-wing network, and you don't want to hear this stuff.
You want to do.
It's not about the kid. It's about you, Jamie. That's good. Okay, thank you, Jamie.
It's about me. I'm doing, yes.
Good night. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you.
Paula Evans, Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Bill, if you are so concerned about public figures being bad role models for children, please stop rudely interrupting your guests and telling them to shut up. Well, the shut up line has happened only once in 6 years, Ms. Evans.
Well, you know, I think that asking a student to stay in the closet in order to go
to
school is a lot like asking an African American student.
No, no, no. Want to know what I was doing?
Shut up.
Please don't tell me to shut up.
Why did you have to tell him you were an atheist if you didn't have any trouble reading the oath? Why didn't you just shut up? What Jimmy Carter should do is privately give Mr. Bush his opinion and shut up publicly. That would be best for the country.
And it is our duty as loyal Americans to shut up once the fighting begins.
Once the war against Saddam begins, we expect every American to support our military, and if they can't do that, to shut up.
The techniques of odd polling and odd graphics of Democrats and weird banners in the lower third of your screen. These are all pretty sophisticated techniques, and they work in collaboration with the most genius marketing slogan in history, which is fair and balanced.
There's no separation between Bill O'Reilly, the interviewer, and Bill O'Reilly with his talking points. I mean, there's just no separation at all.
Jimmy Carter is making yet another mistake, and this time, there's no excuse for it. And that's the memo. Now for the top story tonight, another view on this.
It's very hard on Fox News to separate news from commentary because it all blends together. That's what makes it so ridiculous, that slogan, we report, you decide. Because there's no TV news channel in history that's ever reported less.
For example, a Brit Hume newscast, which is presented as a newscast, I think you see a lot of attitude and opinion both from the anchor and from the reports.
Welcome to Washington. I'm Britt Hume. There was further evidence today that President Bush's days of absorbing John Kerry's attacks without counterattack are over.
We are to believe that Britt Hume is the anchor of a news outlet. He doesn't bring strong politics to it. He just happens to anchor the newscast like Peter Jennings. On Sundays, Britt Hume turns into a rather caustic right-wing pundit.
Look, this goes to Murdoch, too. He doesn't believe in objectivity. He doesn't believe he has contempt for journalism, I think.
Fox blurs the line between news and commentary all over the place.
They wanted all news to be a matter of opinion, because opinion can't be proven false. And I think that's very dangerous, because if people don't have a set of facts that they can agree on, I think it's difficult to reach a consensus on, you know, what's correct public policy.
It wasn't so much a scripted design that promoted the off-the-cuff ad-libs that you see so often on Fox News Channel. It was sort of a reinforcement.
John Kerry is Jane Fonda with a Burberry scarf tied around his neck.
Any ad-lib that made the Democrats look stupid and made the Republicans look smart would get an attaboy, a pat on the back, a wink, or a nod.
Other journalists use phrases like some people say or officials say when they're trying to insert anonymously information in a story that sort of advances the storyline. Fox does it in a different way. Some people say is Fox's cue that I'm pretending to be an anchor, so I can't say this is my opinion or this is Roger Ailes' opinion, but some people say.
Some people say that'd be a pretty good choice. Bring in the Hispanic vote. Some people say, nah, he's posturing.
Some people say, and excuse me, I'll get to you, Joe, in just a second, but some people say that you may be setting up Sharpton for a run against Hillary in 2006 in the Senate.
Journalistically, it's a very peculiar technique, because the idea behind journalism is that you're sourcing who you're referring to. This is just sort of a clever way of inserting political opinion
when you know it probably shouldn't be there.
Some people say that this might undermine what the U.S. troops are doing there.
Some people say
John Kerry has some similarities to an earlier Massachusetts politician.
And some people say, in light of what's happened with the oil for food program,
some people say supported by Iran.
Some say, I've heard a couple people say,
some say that it's a sour grapes book.
Some people say
it's just too violent, there's too much blood.
Some people say something,
if not major, has already happened.
Those are his words.
Some people say it's exploitive. What do you say to that?
To be a Fox News contributor means you're under contract and you're getting paid a set amount.
Joining us in D.C. is Larry Johnson, former CIA officer and former deputy director of the State Department's Office of Counterterrorism.
I came in and was always, you know, I was going to call it as I saw it. For example, the edict came down apparently to stop referring to suicide bombings in Israel as suicide bombings, to call them homicide bombings. I thought that was stupid, and I continue to call them suicide bombings because every bombing that kills someone is a homicide bombing. The question came up about the ability of the United States to fight two wars simultaneously.
Going into Iraq is going to divert resources and attention that should be focused on Al-Qaeda.
And Sean Hannity, being the right-wing cheerleader that he is, was just incensed that I had the temerity to suggest that we couldn't.
We do have the ability and the resources to, we're able to walk and chew gum. We can handle the situation in Iraq, and we can still finish the job of protecting against Al-Qaeda and another attack.
What happens is when the resources end up getting diverted, and particularly the airlift assets required.
Facts don't seem to have any effect upon him. What was unusual is it was after that appearance that even though I was under contract to Fox for another 8 weeks, roughly, they stopped using me.
Your government failed you. Those entrusted with protecting you failed you. And I failed you. And for that failure, I would ask, once all the facts are out, for your understanding and for your forgiveness.
When Richard Clark emerged, it was obvious this was a danger to the administration because he had worked at the highest echelons of the Bush administration. And it was almost like Fox News was working off of the playbook coming out of the White House, that he had to be torn down, he had to be turned into a Democrat, a liberal, a Kerry guy.
He is bringing this up in the heat of a presidential campaign.
Can you assume from what he's saying that he has now become a political operative?
Do you feel that there is a political...
He is, as some have suggested, auditioning for a job in the Kerry administration.
He's sucking up to another administration.
He said when he came to me to ask for my support with Tom Ridge.
He had been angling for a top job in Homeland Security Department and did not get it.
See, one of the things that Fox does and conservatives do is they don't have to win every argument, but if they can muddy the argument enough, if they can turn it into a draw, that to them is a victory because it denies the other side a victory.
Well, Sean, there are apparently two Dick Clarks here.
Dick Clark has been on three sides of a two-sided issue.
Okay. He's totally contradicted himself.
His statements are contradictory.
There's a lot of information that contradicts Clark.
And aren't there sufficient contradictions?
He has written a book, and he certainly wants to go out there and promote that book.
Or is he just out to sell a book?
Who's out to sell his book?
Did he have a motive behind writing the book and going out on 60 Minutes and criticizing the Bush administration?
Obviously, this guy's hawking a book.
Unveiling his book.
An appalling act of profiteering. This guy rakes Bush over the coals and gives Clinton a pass.
And the book gives Clinton a complete pass.
Easily, Clark treats Bill Clinton
era in his book. There are some real concerns about where the truth lies and what Richard Clark was saying.
They launched a major smear campaign. In some ways, it worked.
I thought, number one, he was extremely melodramatic and that he was intoning with great pathos. I mean, it almost seemed like it was a performance.
And it was just attack politics on a TV channel. Usually you leave attack politics to a political campaign.
We are bringing diversity of opinion. There is diversity of opinion on Fox News. You may disagree with that. We have Many liberals there, many liberal invited. We have liberal commentators, as we have conservative ones.
Who are your liberal commentators?
Alan Combs, for one. Greta Van Susteren. It's in the eye of the beholder, I guess.
What they'll try to put on the appearance of being balanced, but really kind of a mismatch. You'll have a Hannity and Combs show where Hannity is a really a good-looking, clean-cut, all-American kind of guy, and his counterpart is a little squirrely-looking, frankly. And you kind of say, he's the liberal? Well, maybe he's not so smart after all. And it sends a subtle message, I think.
You're a good liberal. I agree.
Oh, good liberal, good liberal.
A lot of the times, the liberals that they get to appear on are either faux liberals. Like, I would use Susan Estridge as an example of that, a person who was brought on who essentially agrees with the person on the right in a lot of cases.
And, I am your biggest liberal friend. I do take a little heat. People sometimes say to me, do you really like Sean Hannity?
What's not to like? What does that mean?
I thought I was Sean's biggest liberal friend.
I love you all. I love all my liberal friends.
Or they would just bring on people who were very weak, you know, people who were not well-known people.
We can learn from history, because if we don't, we're condemned to repeat it.
You're not going to get the truth and the facts. You're going to get one guy, Clark, accusing Bush, saying Clinton really, you know, giving him a pass. Then you're going to get the Bush administration attacking Clark. You're not going to get the truth, Marianne. You weren't there. You don't know.
Right. You're probably right about that. And the
even the people who are supposedly liberal in those panel discussions, they know that to challenge the guests and the other hosts too forcefully, they'll certainly find someone else to stand in your place if that's the case.
You're spinning now. I'm not right wing. I believe in global warming.
We looked at special reports, one-on-one interviews. They're once a day. We studied 25 weeks of the one-on-one guest who appeared on special report from late June through mid-December of 2003. Republicans appeared five times as often as Democrats on one-on-one newsmaker interviews. That means that Republicans made up 83% of the partisan guests, while Democrats made up just 17%. In addition, the few Democrats that were interviewed for the show tended to be centrist and conservative Democrats, often brought on to affirm Bush administration policies. So what does this all mean? Well, if Fox were the bastion of fairness and balance that it claims to be, we'd see a lot more balance in this prominent interview segment on the network's most prestigious show. Instead, the numbers indicate that Brit Hume and Special Report choose their guest based on political considerations rather than news judgment.
That's here on the Fox News Channel, the network America trusts for fair and balanced news.
My criticism of Fox News isn't that it's a conservative channel. It's the consumer fraud of fair and balanced. It's nothing of the sort.
What you will see, of course, is intensive discussion about what we call the wedge issues. You'll hear, affirmative action. You'll hear abortion. You'll hear certainly gay rights. God in the separation of church and state issues will be on television every single day.
I think this gay marriage thing is going to be an enormous presidential issue. But there again, we have to be fair and balanced. I mean, we can't, like, run with that.
The stampede of same-sex couples to the altar has accelerated.
President Bush says he's deeply troubled by the hundreds of
2,000 same-sex couples engaged in
2,300 and counting. That's the number
same-sex
of
couples hoping to get
same-sex
married.
Couples wanting to
same-sex marriage.
Their job, which is what the right-wing Republicans want to do, is to divide America up, ignore the important economic, healthcare, environmental issues, and they do that extremely successfully.
They did start up on gay marriage, but I think that they got sort of blindsided. They all of a sudden couldn't show the usual footage they used to show, because they used to love to show the footage, of course, the parades and the black leather and, you know, the drag queens. Then they had, you know, very kind of normal-looking, dumpy, middle-aged couples getting married and smooching on the steps of City Hall. So I've noticed a certain kind of zest going out of the gay marriage thing. But that the opposite, where they've picked up the slack, is on anything to do with religion, anything to do with the Ten Commandments, anything to do with God.
Why is Jesus so popular right now?
Well, I think it depends on who you talk to. I think a lot of people would say that one of the reasons that he's very popular is that Mel Gibson's movie has come out.
George W. Bush because of all this. He wants to see it, and I'm sure they will set up a special screening there at the White House for
him. Sure. Well, yeah. You know, he's a devout Christian.
Right.
Apparently he prays daily.
Do they think it's about just a movie, just entertainment, or do they think that there's really something bigger at work?
Well, I think they think that there's something bigger at work. September 11th threatened people, and people looked to Jesus for comfort. But number two, a line was drawn around the world between two kinds of religions, two kinds of societies.
Freedom is not this country's gift to the world. Freedom is the Almighty's gift to every man and woman in this world.
Boy, couldn't you just see the elite media tremble over that one? The president knows evoking the deity will anger the secular media. He doesn't care. Talking points applauded.
They're going to push God very, very hard, particularly going up into Bush's re-election.
All of us working together can change America one soul at a time.
The Christian fundamentalist movement is one that believes in we're right, you're wrong, no matter what. And I saw a lot of that at Fox. We're right, you're wrong, no matter what.
The O'Reilly factor is probably the perfect example of everything that's wrong with Fox News Channel. You have stories that are selected primarily to upset liberals and Democrats and prop up the Republican Party. You have a hostility towards guests that disagree with the host. And you have a host who, in service of his conservative politics, will distort facts, will misrepresent things, and will... in some cases, just fabricate.
In the personal story segment tonight, we were surprised to find out that an American who lost his father in the World Trade Center attack had signed an anti-war advertisement that accused the USA itself of terrorism.
Jeremy Glick is the son of a Port Authority worker who died at 9/11, and he had signed an anti-war petition, and O'Reilly had to have him on.
And they were so persistent about getting me on the O'Reilly show because they found out that I was on the advisory board and signed a statement that was against the war, and then I was directly impacted by 9/11. The success that I had on the O'Reilly show had to do with just practice and preparation. I taped the shows, and what I did is I took a stopwatch that I used to use for running sprints in high school, and I would see when he has a hostile guest, and I would time how long it takes for him to cut them off.
You were the only one. I was surprised. And the reason I was surprised is that this ad equates the United States with the terrorists.
I said, I'm shocked that you're surprised. And basically just made the only point I wanted to make.
Our current president now inherited a legacy from his father and inherited a political legacy that's responsible for training militarily, economically, and situating geopolitically the parties involved in the alleged assassination and murder of my father and countless of thousands of others. So I don't see why it's so surprising for you to think that I would come back and want to support
escalating Bush's aggression. I'll tell you why it's surprising. You are mouthing a far-left position.
It was extremely intimidating sitting down in the studio because he's really tall. And he lords over you.
You see... I'm sure your beliefs are sincere, but what upsets me is I don't think your father would be approving of this.
Well, actually, my father thought that Bush's presidency was illegitimate.
Maybe he did, but I don't think he'd be equating this country as a terrorist nation.
Well, I wasn't saying that it was necessarily that.
You what signed I'm saying this and is absolutely that said in that.
Jeremy was pretty cool during it, and he was giving his political views, which were very to the left of O'Reilly's.
And he said, I don't really care what you think politically. And I said, obviously you do care, because A, you brought me on the show, and B, I told him that he uses 9/11 and sympathy with the 9/11 families and the lives lost to rationalize his narrow right-wing agenda.
You evoke sympathy with the 9/11 families.
That's a bunch of crap. I've done more for the 9/11 families, by their own admission. I've done more for them than you will ever hope to do.
Okay.
So you keep your mouth shut when you sit me exploiting those people.
You're not representing
me. And I never represent you. You know why?
Why?
Because you have a warped view of this world and a warped view of this country.
Well, explain that. Let me give you an example.
No, I'm not going to debate this with you.
Well, let me give you an example of parallel experiences.
No,
on September 14th.
Here's the record.
On September 14th.
Here's the record. Okay. All right. right? You didn't support the action against Afghanistan to remove the Taliban. You were against it.
Why would I want to brutalize and further punish the people in Afghanistan?
Who killed your father?
The people in Afghanistan didn't kill my father.
Sure they did. The Al-Qaeda people were trained there.
The Al-Qaeda people? What about the Afghans?
See, I'm more angry about it than you are.
So what about George Bush?
What about George Bush? He had nothing to do with it.
The director, senior, as director.
He had nothing to do with it.
So the people that trained 100,000 Mujahideen who were extremists.
I hope your mom isn't watching this. I hope your mother is not watching this.
It's unfair for O'Reilly to evoke both my mom and my father in the interview, especially when I wasn't. You know what I mean? My mom is a grieving widow for a prematurely, a violent, horrific turn in their lives. My dad was only 55. They were working people, you know, working class, middle class. Like, they were not retiring for a while. And their life is basically destroyed. You know, their life together is destroyed, and destroyed in circumstances that I wouldn't wish on my worst enemies, including Bill O'Reilly.
Because you. That's it. I'm not going to say any more.
Okay.
In respect for your father,
it's September 14th, do you want to know what I was doing?
Shut up.
Please don't tell me to shut up.
In respect for your father, who was a Port Authority worker, a fine American, who got killed unnecessarily by barbarians.
By radical extremists trained by this government.
Respect
for
him.
Not the people of America, the ruling class, the small minority.
Cut his mic. I'm not going to dress you down anymore. Out of respect for your father. We'll be back in a moment with more of the
fact. We're done?
We're done.
You see him gesturing to security guards, and then came the after-film performance.
After they're off the air, he said to the kid something to the effect, get out of my studio before I f***ing tear you to pieces. So Jeremy, and I've talked to him since, actually went to the green room to get a cup of coffee.
And the executive producer and the assistant encouraged me to leave the building because they were, quote, concerned that if O'Reilly ran into me in the hallway, he would end up in jail.
This is our house here. If somebody comes to your house and begins spitting on the floor, you'd remove them. Glick was out of control and spewing hatred for this program and his country using vile propaganda.
The next day, I just turned on and watched the follow-up. And saw my views totally distorted. Next thing I know, I was saying Bush planned 9/11.
Glick was saying without a shred of evidence that President Bush and Bush the Elder were directly responsible for 9/11. Now, that kind of stuff is not only loony, it's defamation.
That paints me as a fringe conspiracy nut.
This kid said nothing about President Bush and his father, Bush the Elder, orchestrating the attack on their own country. So O'Reilly's just lying here.
He came on this program and accused President Bush of knowing about 9/11 and murdering his own father.
Glick said, can I sue him? And so I called the lawyer who was in my case of Fox versus Dutton and Franken. He says, well, the kid has to prove that O'Reilly knew he was lying. And O'Reilly is so crazy, he lies so pathologically, that it's harder to prove that O'Reilly knew he was lying. So oddly enough, if someone has a record of crazily lying, it is harder to sue them for defamation.
Vaccine for 25 million.
The key thing is don't be inhaling, don't be ingesting, don't be sucking particles into your body that could get the radiation inside.
All right, we gotta run. Look at this, look at this.
First, your advice is stay inside, don't drink or eat anything.
Many of the themes that are promoted on the Fox News Channel have to do with generating fear. Whether that's fear of immigration, a fear of sexual difference, a fear of racial difference.
When you pander to fear, it's a great motivator and organizer. You've got to keep people alarmed.
They really love this sense of fear and danger, even when it's not there. And so when something is actually dangerous, as some things are, they go completely overboard. And all sense of perspective is lost, so that anthrax, which I guess affected 4 or 5 people adversely, no question about it, is far more dangerous than, you know, the poisoning of our air.
The way we deal with them is the way President Bush is dealing with them. You cordon the area, you search for them, and you shoot them.
The motivator is fear. And then the payoff is, you know, we're going to go out and kill the bad guys. And, you know, it's a very simple black and white world that they paint and portray.
Terrorism has become the all-purpose fear weapon because now everything is converted into terrorism. And of course, if you have a constant sense of unease, then you're going to look to the government to protect you. You're going to look to strong government.
We've removed from power enemies of this country. We have made America more secure.
There are these enemy out there. It's an ill-defined enemy, but as long as we're fighting them and we're killing them and he's looking presidential, then nothing else again is discussed.
What was interesting is in the climate of the Bush administration that much of that fear, the emotion, was purposely misdirected by the right wing into the war in Iraq.
The type of coverage Fox offers, and all of them offer, but Fox is probably the most pristine version, is completely consistent with Bush's with the strategy of the Bush administration, to prevent discussion of things that are not going well, like, for instance, the economy or the Medicare bill.
There's no doubt that the war against Iraq, a country that did not attack us, could only proceed based on fear.
Tonight, it's a special two-hour block.
War is my last choice, but the risk of doing nothing is even a worse option as far as I'm concerned.
Dealing with Iraq, the president's war on terror. When will his military plans get put into action?
We hope you depend on us for the truth, because we're going to report the situation in Iraq without an agenda or any ideological prejudice.
Then you got to take what comes. Not that we hate you, Martin Sheen, but that we may not want to watch your television program anymore because we're identifying you with being against what we believe in.
Americans, and indeed our foreign allies, who actively work against our military once the war is underway, will be considered enemies of the state by me.
But first, are the Americans who went over to Baghdad to act as human shields, well, are they more than just protesters? Are they traitors? So Harry Belafonte, he's at it again. He says the Bush administration is possessed of evil. As the Calypso King gone bonkers. We'll
you have a right to say what you want, but we have a right buy your record. Just fair warning to you, Barbara Streisand, and others who see the world as you do. We don't want to demonize anyone, but anyone who hurts this country in a time like this, well, let's just say you will be spotlighted.
The people survey is interesting because you're looking at questions of basic true-false kind of factual nature. Did we find weapons of mass destruction in Iraq? These are very simple questions with very simple answers. And what the survey found was that the more likely you were to watch Fox News Channel, the more likely you were to have completely incorrect assumptions about these things.
All the research shows a very high correlation in the case of Fox News with people watching it with having a very confused notion of the world on one hand, especially of foreign policy in the Middle East, and also being strongly supportive of the government in power. And this is an extraordinarily disturbing trend for the media. I mean, for any self-respecting journalist, if you're told the more people consume your media, the less they'll know about the subject and the more they'll support government policy. And that's exactly the worst thing any journalist would ever want to hear or should want to hear.
277 U.S. soldiers have now died in Iraq, which means that statistically speaking, U.S. soldiers have less of a chance of dying from all causes in Iraq than citizens have of being murdered in California, which is roughly the same geographical size.
Fox News Channel's stated practice was to embarrass, humiliate, challenge, or disrupt whatever Jesse Jackson did. We were told on many occasions that he was one of our targets. Anything we could do or say that would embarrass him, discredit him, we were encouraged to find the information and we were encouraged to report the information.
I think we have got to appreciate, and when we look at them, is to understand that this is an adjunct of the Republican Party.
What Fox specializes in is punditry, basically getting marching orders from the Republican National Committee or some political operative, and then having people pontificate about it, have guests come on and talk about it, have pseudo-experts come on and discuss it.
Their main allegiances, I'm talking about the people at the top, is to the Republican Party.
Murdoch is absolutely, to his core, a partisan, and he makes no secret about that.
First person who made the call to say that George W. Bush had been elected President of the United States was the person who was in charge of Fox News's election analysis division, the people that crunch the exit polling numbers. That person was a gentleman named John Ellis, and he is George W. Bush's first cousin. At around 2 in the morning on election night, a new set of data had come in, and it was complex data from precincts all over Florida. The proper answer in analyzing that data unquestionably was you couldn't tell. It was too close to call. There was simply no clear winner. Instead, John Ellis called it as a clear win for George Bush. Fox News then interrupted its ongoing election coverage and announced that George Bush had been elected President of the United States.
Fox News now projects George W. Bush the winner in Florida, and thus it appears the winner of the presidency of the United States.
Now, what's significant about that is not the intervention of the president's cousin to declare his relative the new president of the United States. It was the fact that within minutes, ABC, NBC, CBS also fell right in line calling Bush as the winner.
George Bush is the president-elect of the United States.
Bush wins.
ABC News is now going to project that Florida goes to Mr. Bush.
There's no way that they could have crunched the data in that time to come to that conclusion. In fact, quite the opposite. They should have come to the conclusion which Associated Press came to, which was that you couldn't make a call. When Fox made the call that Bush had won and the other networks followed on, that created the perception that Bush was the winner. In fact, he wasn't. But that perception was what really held for the next 37 days. And I would suggest to you that that call on election night had more to do with making George Bush president than any recount or ballot design issue.
We gave our audience bad information. Our lengthy and critical self-examination shows that we let our viewers down. I apologize for making those bad projections that night. It will not happen again.
In the old Soviet Union, you used to hear about the party line shifting 180 degrees. Watching Fox News at the end of Clinton, where it was all attack mode, where they were just vicious watchdogs. And then Bush takes power, and they're like little lapdogs. It was like night and day, and it's a party line shift.
The president has the direction and the vision to take us into the future boldly and with courage and with optimism.
He is an extraordinarily straightforward leader. He says what he's going to do and he does it.
The president stands for steady leadership during a time of enormous change and challenge.
But the president is on Air Force One and the plane is now touched down in New Mexico.
This is as strong a pro-national security conservative president as I've ever seen.
This is a guy who says what he means and means what he says.
But the president is a gentleman. You know, he set a different tone for his campaign.
Super Tuesday lived up to its word. And this was a super night for our candidate, John Kerry, and a super night for the Democratic Party. He's a super nominee.
I believe that in 2004, one united Democratic Party, we can and we will win this election.
What would you say would be Senator Kerry's one or two major weak points that could be exploited?
The presidential hopeful has missed every one of the 22 roll call votes in the Senate this year, but hasn't missed a paycheck.
He talks about trying to protect the taxpayers every single day, and here he is fleecing the taxpayers out of $150,000 a year.
So do you think he should step down, Dominic, when he's running for president?
The controversy over John Kerry and his Vietnam War medals has just gotten worse. He says he never suggested he threw them away, but the videotape does not lie.
Ribbons or medals, which did John Kerry throw away after he returned from Vietnam? His perceived disrespect for the military could be more damaging to the candidate than questions about his actions in uniform.
Many are angry over Kerry's post-war protests.
But the bigger issue here is Kerry's involvement in a group that's inherently violent.
Presumptive Democratic nominee John Kerry was scaring old people, as usual, with the predictable Democratic line. He said President Bush will cut off their entitlement checks. It isn't true, but the lie has worked well for Democrats in the past.
Assuming that the unthinkable happens and that Senator Kerry becomes president.
You're watching Fox News, real journalism, fair and balanced.
They will give you the almost the full Bush stump speech, no matter where it is, no matter how many times they've shown it. Go cut live to these campaign rallies as if there was going to be real news in them, as if Bush was going to say anything earth-shattering.
And your ability to make good decisions, like marrying your wife, Carolyn.
Fox portrays his every action as a heroic move, as a, you know, something dramatic and significant. I imagine it's pretty hard for the Fox producers. Some days George Bush doesn't do anything interesting, and yet they've got to find something that makes him heroic that day.
Most people just started waking up and saying, oh, you mean we don't have the fairness doctrine anymore? I can't tell you how many times when I was a political candidate running for office, I would have somebody come up to me on the street and say, now, I saw your opponent on TV the other day. Aren't they supposed to give you equal time? And I didn't even know for years that we lost that in the Reagan era, that for years we haven't had the ability to expect both sides to be adequately covered.
Clearly, on the Republican side, what we do know is that for years they have coordinated what they call their message of the day. So you'll hear on the floor of the House, you'll hear on Rush Limbaugh, you'll hear on Fox and Rupert Murdoch's network, the issue of the day, which they will pound away at, which then creates the echo chamber, which resonates throughout America.
Here's what he said. I actually did vote for the $87 billion before I voted against it.
Senator Kerry recently said, quote, I actually did vote for the $87 billion before I voted against it. End quote.
Kerry, starting to feel the heat for his flip-flop voting record, is in West Virginia.
Is President Bush doing a good job of defining Kerry as a flip-flopper?
And you're saying he flip-flopped on the issue of this?
Because he does seem to agonize and flip-flop over and over and over again.
He's flip-flopped on all these issues.
Beneath Kerry's flip-flopping
is an opportunistic flip-flopper.
You're talking flip-flops.
New brand of summer footwear, John Kerry flip-flops.
They say that he flip-flops a lot.
So he's flip-flopped now on every major issue.
Would those be the flip-flops?
Because he's flip-flopped on everything else.
Is Senator Kerry guilty of flip-flopping on the issue?
He flip-flops like crazy.
First of all, flip-flop.
You've seen him flip-flop on a whole variety of issues.
Opportunistic flip-flopper who doesn't have any principles. Is that a little harsh?
I think it shows one thing. The weakness of John Kerry.
You're watching Fox News. Real journalism, fair and balanced.
Just 263 days until you get to cast your vote and decide that George W. Bush deserves a second term.
You see a picture of George Bush, you expect to hear organ music that would come out of a church swelling, the backlit head, you know, the Madonna look, and then a picture of John Kerry flashes, and you hear the devil's voice.
This is the devil. He is evil.
Is it true, the reports that we're seeing, did John Kerry on the slopes curse out a Secret Service agent? Is that true?
I think Kerry needed this vacation. He was showing some fatigue. I mean, the crooks...
Only 217 days and counting until George W. Bush is reelected.
They're saying John Kerry looks French.
John Kerry looks French.
Kerry, the man who would be America's first French president.
When you're at war, there are two models. You have the Churchill, Reagan, Thatcher, Tony Blair, George Bush model, or you have the McGovern, Jimmy Carter, French John Kerry model.
Are the Republicans going to effectively be able to make Kerry French? Good afternoon, everybody, or as John Kerry would say, bonjour.
French are thinkers, and that doesn't go into the code of the American presidency. I mean, you know the French, the thinker, le penseur, Rodin. I mean, they think, and they never do anything with their thinking. I believe that Mr. Kerry has to get away of this image if he wants to win. Right now, I think he's not in the American archetype. Why? He's on vacation. If the archetype is to take action and you are taking vacation, I mean, you're definitely not, you don't fit the code, you are off code.
And Mr. Rafai, thank you very much. You are hereby invited back.
204 days until George W. Bush is reelected.
We're creating jobs. Good, high-paying jobs for the American citizens.
The president goes to Charlotte to talk about job training. Buoyed by the 300,000 job figure last week, he can boast his policies are working.
New jobs grew last month at the fastest rate in 4 years.
With the news this morning, 308,000 new jobs were created last month. They're drinking the Maalox right out of the gallon bucket at the Kerry campaign.
What this Kerry plan will do is punish successful companies, and that's bad.
If you want to destroy jobs in this country, you raise taxes.
John Kerry's plan to bring millions of jobs back to America. Well, someone here says, watch out. Kerry's plan will end up killing more jobs instead.
There you have it, 196 days till we re-elect George W.
Wait, the election's over? All right, thanks for letting me know.
It's almost there.
MSNBC, I worked as a senior producer on the Phil Donahue primetime show. From the beginning, they were saying to us, we have to be balanced, giving them instructions not to be too confrontational, don't be too partisan, don't be too angry. Now, by the end of our tenure, balance wasn't enough. And this is the Fox effect. They mandated that if we had two left-wing guests, we had to have three right-wing guests. If we had one anti-war guest, we had to have two pro-war guests. And that's how we ended the show. So we're like trying to outfox Fox. You cannot outfox Fox. But MSNBC and the others have tried. CNBC has tried to outfox Fox. Since the corporate structures, corporate ownership of the other channels does not allow anyone to counter-program against Fox, you know, in television, the inclination is imitation.
You know, I think the standard right now is Fox, and I want to be as interesting and as edgy as you guys are.
It's influencing its competitors. That's why, MSNBC hired Joe Scarborough. That's why CNN in recent weeks has taken to reporting pretty much anything the Bush White House tells it to report. There is a sense now that there is money in the flag, and Fox knows that, and its competitors know that Fox is onto something.
When you let a small number of companies have this much concentrated power, they will always abuse it. It's simply unacceptable in a free society. And if you don't change the system, we can be having this conversation for the next 50 years. We'll be talking about Rupert Murdoch III.
Voor meer informatie, het lidmaatschap op onze wekelijkse nieuwsbrief en reacties, surft u naar tegenlicht.vpro.nl.
Dit is een oproep voor alle kijkers. Aankomende zondag is er de grote VPRO Amerika-avond. Live vanuit Felix Meritus in Amsterdam, waarin deskundigen, leken en andere bijzondere gasten hun liefde voor Amerika uitspreken. We hebben verslag van een bijzondere busreis van oost naar west, waarin prominente VPRO-filmmakers spreken met Amerikanen over de toestand in Amerika aan de vooravond van de verkiezingen. We hebben een bericht van Levi en Saregi, die verblijven bij de Indianen in South Dakota. Liefdesverklaringen, analyse en treurige mijmeringen live vanuit Felix Meritus in Amsterdam.